Hi everyone. Today's video is about attachment, the history of attachment, and the process of attachment development. I am your professor, Dr. Jennie Rosier. Let's get started. Attachment theory was developed by British psychiatrist John Bowlby in the late 1940s. It was actually a reaction to his personal life being shipped off to boarding school when he was 7 years old, and him being a psychiatrist and watching children who were separated from their parents during the bombings of London have some pretty extreme reactions to that separation. And so he started to examine mother and child separation. And he focused on moms because it was the 1940s. I mean, mom was primary caregiver. Modern attachment theory, however, really focuses on anyone who is a primary caregiver for a child. So dad, mom, grandparents, daycare provider, nanny, teacher at school, lots of people can become an attachment figure for a child. But in its beginnings, John Bowlby really talked about mother and child. Attachment theory tries to explain how an infant uses a attachment figure to downregulate their own stress. We do it as adults too, and we'll get to adulthood attachment in adulthood later, but the beginnings of attachment theory were really about young children and how this bond is created between, again, we'll say mother and baby, and that bond, if it's a really secure attachment bond, can help a child downregulate their own stress. Unfortunately, sometimes parents react to children in ways during times of distress that creates an insecure bond, and that can make it so that a child cannot downregulate their stress, and it can have some other dire consequences that we'll talk about in another video. All humans are born with a really strong desire to form connections with other people. We want to be around other people very badly, especially as infants. If you've ever been around a baby, you know that they really just want to be held all the time. And sometimes that can be difficult for parents. We'll talk about that in another video. But when an infant is small, they want to form bonds with other people so that they can feel safe and secure. Unfortunately, sometimes the adults who are around an infant don't really have the ability or the motivation or the energy to give the child that would be appropriate to form those attachment bonds, and insecure bonds are developed. But we all have this desire when we are born to form connections with other people, to feel safe and secure. When we feel safe and secure, we experience a lot of benefits. When babies feel secure, when they feel safe in their relationship with their primary caregiver, they're actually better able at independently exploring the world around them. I know this seems kind of counterintuitive. The more attention and affection and love that you give a child, the more that you nurture their need for clinginess or dependency on you in early childhood, the more likely that they are going to be independent and not clingy and not needing you every second of the day for everything in later childhood. So it's really important that you nurture that need for dependency now so that they can feel safe to explore on their own later. Babies who feel safe and secure tend to explore the world around them more freely. Babies who feel insecure might not leave a parent's side, even in a comfortable environment or an environment that should feel pretty safe. And this idea of like going out into the world and then coming back to the parent and then going out into the world and coming back to the parent is called the circle of security. So children who have a really good attachment bond with their parent or their primary caregiver, when they are with that primary caregiver, they are able to explore the world around them. And anytime on their exploration, if they feel distress or nervous or scared, they retreat back to the primary caregiver to help them downregulate their stress. So all babies experience distress. And it's not just because they have a wet diaper or because they're hungry or because they're tired. Babies experience distress for all kinds of things. They might be scared. They might be worried about something in their environment, like an animal, a dog, or a cat, or toys are out of place, or furniture is moved, and it could make them feel a little uncomfortable. Or they might just be lonely. You know, a lot of people don't give babies enough credit for having a wide range of emotions. And I would argue that if you can feel it, a baby can feel it. So babies feel lonely and they just want to be near their primary caregiver. When a baby is in distress, their typical reaction is to cry. When a baby cries and you are with them, it is your responsibility to help them downregulate that stress. So whether you are the parent or the grandparent, or you're the babysitter just for the night, if a baby is in distress, it is your job to help them downregulate that stress. Babies cannot downregulate stress on their own. They need loving, caring, sensitive, and responsive adults to help them downregulate their stress. So let's go over that attachment development process again. Babies cry when they're in distress. Based on the quickness of the response from a primary caregiver, the consistency of the responses, and the positivity and sensitivity of those responses, a baby develops internal working models in their brains. So let's go over two examples, baby A and baby B. Baby A cries, and mom is well rested. Mom just knows that she has the energy and the time to attend to baby. Mom quickly gets to baby, talks to the baby, says, you know, what's wrong, picks baby up, rubs baby's back, is very responsive in a sensitive, loving way. Baby downregulates stress. Baby A's mom consistently behaves this way. Every single time baby A cries, mom's right there. Every single time baby A needs mom or dad or grandma, the adult is there. And the adult is always responding in a consistently loving way. That baby develops internal working models in their brain that tell them that, hey, adults are trustworthy. If I need an adult, they'll be there for me. I'm a pretty good person. Other people are pretty good people. Relationships seem pretty worthwhile. The world is a great place to be. Internal working models tell us how to view ourselves, how to view others, how to view relationships, and how to view the world around us. We want to create human beings who view themselves positively, view other people positively, view relationships as valuable, and view the world as a happy, safe place to be. Now let's talk about baby B. Baby B cries. Baby B's mom is tired, feels overworked, and maybe can't come to baby right away. Baby cries and cries and cries, and mom is so stressed out. She just can't handle it. So she, you know, tries to let the baby cry on their own, and, you know, they'll get over it. They'll, like, learn how to self-soothe. I'm sure you've heard that term before. And so baby B starts to wonder, if this happens repeatedly, if this is a consistent pattern of behavior, baby B starts to think, well, you know, maybe adults aren't that trustworthy. Maybe they're not that great. And maybe it's because I'm not that great. So baby B could develop negative views of themselves, negative views of others, negative views of relationships. They're not that worthwhile. Negative views of the world around them. This is not what we want. We don't want people who are viewing everything and everyone negatively. Now, it doesn't mean that a person who maybe slips up every once in a while and doesn't respond to baby is going to have an insecure baby. This is about consistent patterns of behavior. This is, does your baby know that if they are in distress, that you will most likely be there? You most likely will help them. Or have they come to realize that you most likely will not be there? You most likely will not help them. Or have they have no idea what your response is going to be? That's also not so great. They need to be able to predict your behavior. So we need to work on creating baby A as much as we can, because around 18 to 36 months of age, and that's a wide gap, and the reason researchers disagree. Some researchers believe it's 18 months. Some researchers believe it's 36 months. Around the first 3 years of life, babies develop an attachment foundation that they carry with them for the rest of their lives, impacting how they create, maintain, and even end friendships, family relationships, coworker relationships, romantic relationships for the rest of their lives. Well, that's a wrap. I'm Dr. Jennie Rosier, Associate Professor of Communication Studies at James Madison University. I'm also the director of the RLH Project. You can find me on Instagram at RelationshipsLoveHappiness or on Facebook at /RelationshipsLoveHappiness. Thanks for watching.